Now, in this video, let us look at the question number 21 to 25, that means the last set of 1 mark questions. Then we will come back to the 2 mark questions here. Okay. Now, in the question number 21, they are giving us a C program and they are asking us what is the output of the C program, or you can say what is the value of this counter. And as you can see here, counter is a global variable. Okay. So, assuming that this is our global variable, which is counter. And initially it is storing the value 0. So we made this function call. So we are initially calling cal c 4, 81, where 4 is the value of a and 81 is the value of b. Okay, and these are the statements, line number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So we'll check all the lines one by one. But remember guys, here they're only checking, asking us what is the value of the counter. So we may find some shortcut while solving this question. So in the part 1, they are creating int c. So we'll be having a variable c. Then we are incrementing the value of counter. So in the line number 2, we are incrementing the value of counter as 1. Then in the line number 3, they are checking if b is equal to 3, then return a into a into a. The value of b is 81. It is not 3, so line number 3 will not be executed. Then we'll be executing line number 5, which will be c is equal to cal c 4 comma b divided by 3, which is 81 divided by 3 is 27. Okay, so here we passed the value of variable a. We just passed this value, we have not changed this value at all, we just changed the value of b. Now, before executing the statement number 6, we have to execute the statement number 5. The statement number 5, again, this is the value of A, this is the value of B, and we'll create a variable C again. Again, in the line number 2, we'll execute counter plus plus, so the value of counter will become 2, and then the value of B is not 3, so we'll execute the line number 5. So, line number 5 will be C is equal to cal C 4 comma 27 divided by 3, which is 9. Then only we'll execute the last statement, which is this one. Okay, now after this, again this is the value of a, this is the value of b, then there is a variable c. Line number 1, line number 2 will not be executed, line number 3 will not be executed, line number 3 will not be executed. Line number 2 is counter plus plus, the value of counter will become 3. The line number of 5 will become c is equal to cal c 4 comma 9 divided by 3, which is equal to 3. Okay, again this recursive call will be there. Then line number 1 will be executed, which is variable c. Line number 2 will be executed, which is the value of counter will become 4. And then line number 3 here, as you can see, it will be executed perfectly. So line number 3 is return the value of a into a into a, which is 4 into 4 into 4, which is 64. Okay. Now guys, they are only asking us the value of the counter, they are not asking us what is the return value of this entire function. So we don't actually have to understand what is the return value of this all this recursive call, because we only need the value of the counter. Okay, but in any ways I can solve this question easily for you, but that will become quite a long calculation from here. Fine, so we only need the value of the counter, and the maximum value of the counter that will reach after this 4 function calls will be 4. So the output of this program will become 4, correct? After this, now let us check out the next question. Now this next question is from Digital Logic, and they are using the D flip-flops in this question. They are saying, consider the sequential circuit shown in the figure where both flip-flops used a positive edge triggered D flip-flop. These are both positive edge triggered, as you can see, D flip-flops, and the number of states in the state transition diagram of the circuit that have a transition back to the same state on some value of in is. So what is the number of states in the state transition diagram of the circuit? Okay, now let us try to solve this question here. Now guys, this is a very easy question. The only thing is that you should know how to draw the state transition diagram for this. Okay, see, these both are D flip-flops, and D flip-flops are called as a delayed flip-flop. What does that mean? That if this is the D, this is Q, and this is Q new, that this is a new value of the next state. Okay, their combinations can be 00, 01, 10, 11. Okay, Now, in case of D flip-flop, the output will always be same as the input. The only thing is that output will be delayed. Okay, so I think you should draw the state transition diagram like this. This is Q, D, and this is Q. So whatever the input is, that same thing will be output, and whatever the input is, the same thing will be the output. The only thing, there will be a delay in the output. It is just used to store one bit of information which you can use later on. Okay, now when we have to draw the state diagram, so we have to draw this state diagram according to this input only. Okay, so initially we don't know what is the value of Q and Q, these Q1 and Q2, assuming that we are just going to assume these values, assuming that initially these values are 0 0. Okay, that means we are denoting the state as 0 0, where both Q and Q1 and Q2 both are 0 0. Now if you give input as 0, so the next state after giving this input as 0, the next state will be 0, and here also the next state will be 0, because here input was 0. So if you give input as 0, so next state is also 0 0, correct? Now if I have to draw a lot here, but still I'll try to solve it properly. Now if, let us say, I give input as 1 and initially these values are 0 0. Okay, now because it is just a delayed flip-flop, this 0 will shift here, so we get 0 here, and this 1 will shift here, we get 1 here. So that means if we give a 1 to this, then I going to the state which is equal to 1 0. Okay, I hope that you understood this one. Okay, so let me erase this again for simplicity purposes, so that you don't get confused because of this. Now we are at state 1 0, that means 1 is here and 0 is here. Now the next input can be 0. If at the state 1 0, we are giving the input as 0, now this 1 will shift here and this 0 will shift here. They are just shifting in the D flip-flops. So the next state will be 0 and 1. So in 1 0, if I give a 0, then we are going to a next state which is 0 1. Okay, so this is 0 and this is 1, right? Now in case of 1 0, if we are giving the input as 1, right? So much rubbing here. Okay, so for this in examination hall, it is better to have a pencil, because otherwise you'll face a lot of problems. But in state 1, 0, if we are giving input as 1, then what will happen? This will shift here and this will shift here. So the next state will be 1 here and 1 here. So in case of 1, 0, if I am giving 1, then I'm going to go to the next state, which is 1, 1. Correct? Now let's take those two states again. Correct? Now if we are having the state as 1 1, this 1 here and 1 here, that is this state. If we are giving 0 here, then this 0 will come here and this 1 will come here. That means the next state will be 0 and 1. So 0 and 1. If we are giving 0, then we will go to the 0 and 1 state, right? But instead of this, if we would have given both the states are 1, if we would have given 1 as an input, now this 1 will shift here and this 1 will shift here. So it will again go back to its own state if we give input as 1, right? I hope that you understood this properly. Let us take the other transitions here. If, let us say, we are at this state which is 0, 1, 0 here and 1 here, and we are giving an input as 0, now this 0 will shift here and this 0 will shift here, so we get the next input as, next states are 0, 0. So that means if we are giving 0 here, then next state will be 0 0. Now if in the same way, the same state, if we are giving 1 as an input, so this 1 will shift here and this 0 will shift here, so it will become 1 0. That means if we are giving 1 as an input, then we will go to the state 1 0. Correct? Now I hope that I have taken all the possible states for two variables. There are only 4 possible states, either it can be 0 0 or 0 1 or 1 0 or 1 1. So we have created transition for all the 4 states. For every possible input, there is only 2 possible inputs, which is 0 0 0 1 and 1 0. Okay, now they are asking in the question is that the number of states in the state transition diagram of the circuit that have a transition back to the same state, that means the transition back to the same state, that means that are having self loop on some variable of input. Now there are only 2 states here which are having self loop. One is this state, this is having a self loop, as well as the second one is this state, which is having the self loop. So there are 2 states, right? So because there are 2 states, therefore the answer to this question is 2, which are having, 2, there are 2 states which are having self loops. Okay. I hope that you understood this question easily. Let us look at the next question. The question number 23 says, a 32-bit wide main memory unit with a capacity of 1 GB is built using 256 M x 4-bit DRAM chips. Okay. The number of rows of memory cells in the DRAM chip is 2^14. The time taken to perform one refresh operation is 50 nanoseconds. The refresh period is 2 milliseconds and the percentage that is rounded to the closest digit of the time available for the performing the memory read-write operation the memory unit is. So they're asking us ki, what is the percentage of time available to perform the memory read-write operations. Okay. Now there are few things that they have already given. We just have to write those few things one by one. So for one is they are giving us that refresh rate. So one refresh operation takes around 50 nanoseconds. Okay. And they're also giving us what is the total number of rows. It is because they are saying it as it is 256 M x 4-bit DRAM and it is a 32-bit wide memory. Okay. And they are giving us the number of rows of memory cells in the DRAM. You just focus clearly on this. The number of rows of memory cells of the DRAM is 2^14. So the number of rows of memory cell in DRAM is 2^14. That means if this is a DRAM, okay, now there are 2^14 rows here. 2^14 rows here. Okay. Now to refresh one row, it takes 50 nanoseconds. So time to refresh 2^14 rows will be 50 nanosecond multiplied by 2^14, which comes out to be 819200 nanoseconds, which is approximately 0.819200 milliseconds. So you can calculate it accordingly. Okay. Therefore, here the refresh period here, what they are giving is the refresh period is 2 milliseconds. So a refresh period here is 2 milliseconds. Correct. Now, what is the percentage of time spent in a refresh period will be total time to refresh all rows divided by the refresh period multiplied by 100. Okay. Now, total time to refresh all rows is 0.8192 milliseconds. And the refresh period is 2 milliseconds as they are giving. So, it is 2 milliseconds multiplied by 100. You can calculate this value. I have already calculated it before. So, it is 40.96% of time. Therefore, a part of this, the other remaining time is the time spent on read-write operation. So we got what is the refresh percentage or percentage of time spent to refresh. Therefore, percentage of time spent in read-write period, that will be equal to 100 minus 40.96, which is approximately 59.04%. Okay, and now they are asking the answer to be rounded to the closest digit, because they are asking the answer to be rounded to the closest digit. 9.4 can be written as 59 as a closest integer. So the answer to this question is 59%. Correct. I hope that you understood this one. Now for this concept, I think you should know what is this configuration. Just go check out my videos on computer architecture, then you'll get these videos over there. Okay. Now the question number 24 is comparatively very, very easy question, and I hope this is one of the easiest question in the examination, as you already know. They are saying consider a system with 3 processes that share 4 instances of same resource type. So we have 3 processes, assuming that the process P1, P2 and P3, and we have 4 instances of resources of same resource type. Each process can request a maximum of k instances. So this can request a max of k instances, this can request a max of k instances, this can request a max of k instances. Now they are saying the resource instances can be requested and released only one at a time. Now the largest value of k that always avoid deadlock. Okay, that will always avoid deadlock. What does it mean or what do they want to say? They want to say that there are three processes, P1, P2, P3. Now P1 require k units of resource to finish its operation, P2 require k and P3 require k. Now what is the value of largest value of k that can always avoid deadlock, because we have four instances of this resource type, correct? Now to every process, if we give one resource less, then we can have a deadlock. For example, here instead of in P1, instead of giving k, I can give k-1 resources. To P2, I can give k-1 resources. To P3, I can give k-1 resources. That is a total of 3k-3 resources. That means if to these processes, if we give these many resources, then still we can have a deadlock. Okay, now they want to say that can you find what is the number of resources required if we do not want to have a deadlock. Now if we give a maximum of these many resources to these processes, then still we can have deadlock. But if you give one resource extra to this, then we'll not be having deadlock. That means we'll be having k 3k minus 2. If we give these many resources, then we will not be having deadlock. Okay, now these 3k minus 2, whatever these resources can be, they will always be less than 4, because a maximum resources that we have is 4. So they will always be less than or equal to 4. So if you calculate the value of k, so I can write 3k should be less than or equal to 6. Therefore k should be less than or equal to 2. That means to every process, if they require at maximum of 2 resources to finish, that means for example P1 process required 2 resources, P2 process required 2 resources, P3 process required 2 resources, and we have a total of 4 resources, then we will not be having deadlock. So the answer that they are asking, what is the largest value of k that will always avoid deadlock, is 2. So if we have a value greater than 2, then we will be having deadlock for this given question. Then I hope that you understood this one. Let us look at the next question. It's a very simple question again, but you should know the concepts of TCP. Let us look at this one. Consider a long-lived TCP session with an end-to-end bandwidth of 1 Gbps, which is 10 to the power 9 bits per second. The session starts with a sequence number. This is a sequence number of a session. The minimum time in seconds rounded to the closest digit before the sequence number can be used again. Okay, so this sequence number can be used again. Obviously, when they're asking sequence number that can be used again, so they're just asking about the wrap around time. Okay, what is the wrap around time? That when you have a set of sequence numbers, assuming that these are set of sequence numbers from 0 to some sequence number n, we are starting with the sequence number 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, now what is the time taken for using all the sequence numbers from here to here, and then using all the sequence numbers from here to here from starting? So that is called as a wraparound time. That means from this point we started and we again reached to this point, that is called as a wraparound time. Okay, now here if they are asking the wraparound time, that I can say what is the T wraparound, wraparound time, that can be written as in TCP we use actually 32 bits to represent the sequence number, 32 bits to represent sequence number. Okay, so for the 32 bits, there are 2 raised to power 32 sequence numbers that are possible, correct? Now here we have to calculate what is the total wraparound time, correct? For total wraparound time, you understand that these many bits per second we are sending, therefore what is the number of so what will be, we are using these bits, so we have to convert these bits to bytes. So we can write it as 10 raised to power 9 divided by 8, correct? Now here we can say what the T wraparound time, that will be because for every byte we'll be using one sequence number in TCP, right? So we'll be having, divide this by 10 raised to power 9 by 8, that can be written as 2 raised to power 32 multiplied by 8 divided by 10 raised to power 9, that can be calculated as 34.355. I've already calculated this value here. Now what is the closest, they are saying what is the minimum time, this is important thing, what is the minimum time before the sequence number can be used again. So what is the minimum time before the sequence number can be used again? That is equal to minimum of 34.355, which can be written as 34 seconds. Okay, so because they are giving bits per second, this is bits per second, so this will be in 34 seconds. But if they are asking what is the maximum time, then we can say it is 35. Instead of 34, we can say 35 if they are asking maximum, and if they are asking what is the minimum time, that it will be 34 seconds. Okay, I hope that you understood these questions. Now in the next video, we'll start with the 2 marks questions, which are from question number 26 to question number 55. Okay.